baby, oh baby, we got ourselves a controversy. Let's go. Woo! That's how it is, baby. Every time. Welcome back to the channel. Yeah, today we're talking about the Game Awards, or the lack of games in 2024.
I'm just going to come out and say it.
2024, honestly, in gaming has been a pretty mid-year, especially after what we saw recently with the Game Awards nominations, which really... There's always something going on there, isn't there? Good old Jeff Keighley Borelli, I guess so, my boy. And look, I'm sure some of you are already really angrily typing in the comment section, how could you say it was a mid-year? All these great games came out. Yes, they did, but compared to other years, it definitely was not even close into what we got in terms of video games. However, though, my point has been proven, because apparently Jeff Keighley and the Game Awards decided to go ahead and allow DLCs into the Game of the Year conversation. DLCs and expansions into the Game of the Year conversation makes absolutely zero sense whatsoever. I don't know why you would even allow anything like that. I don't know why you wouldn't just have their own category for best expansion / DLC for the year. I don't get it, because you know what? Shadow of the Erdtree is going to win Game of the Year again, baby. Elden Ring Game of the Year 2 years in a row. And as much fun as it would be for me to make salt content about that, I really feel like gaming needs a better class of award show, honestly, because this thing has been nothing but an entire commercial the last few years. In fact, it's always been kind of bad, and I don't know why everybody continues to just hound out about this thing. Everything from Keighley trying to copyright claim Game Awards, as if you can make a copyright about two specific words put together, which really makes no sense whatsoever, to then now hiding all the judges that were part of the Game Awards committee who nominated those games for the awards, really comes into question of who's actually doing these things. Are they even relatable to video games? Do any of these judges even know what's actually happening? Do they even understand what's going on? Now, there has been some other controversies as well, especially throughout the year with Black Myth Wukong. Now, personally, okay, this is just me. This is just me talking here, okay? I really didn't jive with Black Myth Wukong very much. I only did the PC port review, and then I just kind of like turned it off and never touched it again. I may go back to it, I may not. However, though, the entire controversy surrounding it, with so many journalists attacking that game and the way that game was approached in the industry, kind of pulls into question, yes, something is going on, because on top of that, Stellar Blade wasn't nominated as many times as you would like. Because on top of that, even though I haven't gotten to play Stellar Blade yet, even though it's coming to PC, and I know when them mods, boy, when that baby hits PC, oh, them Futanari mods, they're gonna be banging. Banging. There have been some concerns that I have with some of the categories. Now, here's the fun part. We did this video last year, and everybody got their old little panties in a bunch because I was talking about games and categories and how the categories and those games inside those categories didn't match well together. I'm a bit of a in the tism spectrum, if you want to ask me. And everybody got really mad, being like, how could you talk about those games if you never played them? I'm not talking about the games specifically. I'm talking about the games and the categories and why the categories don't make sense. So let's try that one again, shall we? Right off the bat, I want to go right into Game of the Year. Here's the thing. Astrobot, everybody really liked it. It was a pretty cool game from what people are saying. Sure. Balatro, no. Although I'm playing Balatro right now and I can understand its appeal, it is definitely hitting that sort of like card game, Path of Exile combo kind of a thing. Yes, I do like that a lot, but I don't consider it Game of the Year so far, especially because it's a card game, roguelike, stat-based combo system, which is kind of cool, but I couldn't consider this Game of the Year. Black Myth Wukong, sure, I didn't like it, but I can see how its insane popularity has just garnered so many people to actually nominate this game. It would make sense for it to be there. Elden Ring Shadow of the Erdtree, it shouldn't be there. I'm sorry, it shouldn't be there. I haven't gotten to the DLC yet, but the thing is, it's DLC. As good as that DLC is by everybody else's standards, it makes no sense why this is here for Game of the Year. It's an expansion to the game. I require the original game to play it. Why is it here? Here's my better question. Why isn't Warhammer 40K Space Marine 2 here? Wouldn't that make a lot more sense? I mean, that game basically just everything this year, honestly, in my opinion. It has been one of the best games so far, because every time I played that game and when I finished it, I had nothing but a giant smile on my face because, oh, look, finally, video games are back. But no. Okay. Fine. FF7 Rebirth. Look, I've made it very clear that I don't like the FF7 remakes, even though they're actually sequels to the original FF7. But still, when it hits PC, we'll do the port review and we'll play it there, I guess, whatever. Metaphor, I heard it was good. I'm more of a Persona 3 Reload man myself, but I have my own arguments about that category too, so let's continue. All right, let's talk about best narrative. You got Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, you've got Like a Dragon, you've got Metaphor, you've got Hellblade, and you've got Silent Hill 2. Where is Persona 3? If we're sitting here making all these kinds of different rules and bending things around, being like, oh, remakes and remasters can be Game of the Year now, and DLC can be Game of the Year now, where is Persona 3 Reload? I want to know. I'm going to Persona 3 myself right off this. Okay. Whatever. So I'm going to bring this up here because I think it's actually kind of funny. The amount of Gok 9000ing that was happening for Dragon Age Veilguard the last couple of weeks, even though honestly from its outside looking in and being a Dragon Age Origins fan myself, that game looked mid as f***. Just saying it like it is. I just don't even care about that game whatsoever. All of the actual glazing that happened for that game, this is the only award it's nominated for. Innovation and accessibility. The only one. I guess IGN giving it that 9 really paid off now, didn't it? So here is where the rubber meets the road for me, honestly. We're going to be talking about best ongoing game. You've got Destiny 2, Diablo 4, FF14, Fortnite, and Helldivers 2. Okay, let's really break this brass tacks down. Destiny 2 and Diablo 4, get that trash the hell out of here! I don't understand how nobody has looked at Path of Exile at the fact that Settlers of Kalgar has been an insane expansion the entire time, and PoE has been doing this for 10 years and has had, what, zero noms in this category? None? We're just gonna forget that game exists. We're just gonna slap Destiny 2 in there again, Fortnite in there again, Diablo 4, which had nothing to do with that entire game for best ongoing. They had to basically restructure the entire game from top to bottom, and even now the new season is in the trash because nobody likes it, and the expansion was a dumpster fire. So what are we doing here with best ongoing? Huh? Where's Power World? Why isn't that there? Okay, because it gets better. Let's talk about the best community support now, too, because this is the one where things get wild for me. All right, you've got Baldur's Gate 3 because they just finished patch 7, which, of course, is huge for that game. FF14, clearly because they just did, like, FF11 in that game all over again. They've got Fortnite again, Helldivers 2, and No Man's Sky. Now, look here. No Man's Sky is the sleeper horse of sleeper horses. That thing is a dark horse that continues to ride because the guys who made that game for Hello Games have really just brought everything back, and I really have to get back into that game. I only played a little bit of it, but just seeing the updates that what they do to that game is honestly insane. It's a whole brand new thing from what I've been reading. Helldivers 2, the controversy surrounding that game has been nonstop every single time. However, though, PC gamers holding that game up like the stellar that it is. I don't really like it that much. I played a couple of games, didn't really strike me very well. But either way, that has had a massive community support because of the fact that they've fixed a lot of things. Where's Warhammer? The amount of patches that game has had, the amount of community support that's been behind that game, the way that the actual developers work with that game to fix patches and bugs, fix balancing issues, all across those things, where is that? And why is Fortnite here again? And what is this category in the first place? Outstanding community support, transparency, and responsiveness. Fortnite shouldn't be there. And if by that category, Helldivers... What? It had the biggest controversy the entire year. Talk about transparency and responsiveness. By that category alone, it shouldn't be there. Okay. But all right. No. Let's continue. Best indie game. Well, I think it's pretty sure that these are all actually indie games this time. Animal is made by Donkey. Bellatro is made by one guy. I haven't heard of Lorelei, Neva, or UFO 50, but these seem like they're not made by a giant conglomerate again to then be passed off as an indie game so that way everybody can suck off on it. So at least good job there, I guess. Here we go with Best RPG. Another snub for Persona 3. Another snub. What are we doing here? What are we doing here? I have to play Metaphor. It was gifted to me. Somebody, you know, Bathy Wathy got it for me in the community. But still, what are we doing here? Why is it that we're just ignoring Persona 3? Strange to me, honestly. But then seeing all of that and then seeing my examples of what's been happening with Game of the Year and noticing that you can't see who the judges are, you're trying to see Jeff Keighley just add whatever rule they can possibly add because of what he wants to do for this year and how they can actually apply it, which is going to be funny because if 2025 is a banger year, then are they going to keep the same rule for DLC for being Game of the Year? Or is that going to change because, oh, we heard our feedback because maybe 2025 won't be mid again for gaming? Here's the thing. Bellatro should have stayed as Best Indie Game of the Year. That's where it should have been. I'm really enjoying it right now, but honestly, I don't feel it holds a candle to what these other games have done in the industry right now. Elden Ring, Shadow of the Erdtree, it shouldn't be here for Game of the Year. It shouldn't. It should be either Best Ongoing, Best DLC, anything along that lane. That's where that category and that DLC should be. It shouldn't be here for Game of the Year. Adding a DLC to what a Game of the Year should be is not the right way of categorizing video games. That's my biggest problem with the Keighleys, is what I'm going to call it, because every single time he does something, it's always the same garbage back and forth over and over. It's never anything the way it should be. Honestly, Bellatro, Best Indie Game, then you've got Warhammer 40K Space Marine here, and you could have also just replaced Stellar Blade with Elden Ring or any other game that came out this year on top of that matter. I don't know, Persona 3 Reload would have been a great choice on top of that too. But what I can say though is Sega sweep. If you want to talk about who's making great games every single year, apparently it's Sega. Because damn, that's a hell of a thing going on. Now look, we see this every single year where apparently judges and game critics and all these other people don't understand what categories are for video games, or they like to apply their own rules or change things up throughout their time frame. I feel like 2024 was in fact a pretty mid-year for video games, seeing as how a lot of games didn't really catch my attention or really want me to play them besides a very select few. Usually, we're trying to figure out which game is going to be the game of the year, but this year, I feel like it was very tough to call. Personally, I think what's going to win it is going to be either Elden Ring, the DLC for Shadow of the Erdtree, or possibly Wukong. I don't think anything else will catch up, mostly because of how large Wukong was in the space in terms of just a global popularity sensation and how much people really enjoyed Elden Ring Shadow of the Erdtree, especially with Kai's stream on that, which was honestly phenomenal, and everybody else just really enjoying that game and playing it once again. Would be really funny, though, to have a DLC when Game of the Year and Elden Ring be back-to-back Game of the Year winners. That would be hilarious. But the thing is, this only goes to show that Jeff Keighley truly has zero idea what video games in fact are. And all it really does is boil down to the fact that a lot of the judges, a lot of people in the industry don't understand what video games in fact even are, what gamers actually like to see, or what games are actually being enjoyed by the community, people who are actually playing video games. I think that's the big problem with all of this. I feel like there's a massive disconnect between all of these things. And it would have been even more apparent if you would have seen Dragon Age Veilguard be nominated for even more awards or even in the Game of the Year category. That would have been the nail in the coffin, in my opinion, for this award show, because everyone would have looked at them and said, what are you even fucking doing here, you clowns? Now look, this is going to be a clown show like it always is. Hopefully Gillette Man makes a return. But the problem is that this entire thing truly has no concept and no idea of what the community actually likes in video games, what people actually like in video games, and it's being snuffed out and putting out the voices of actual gamers and raising the voices of gaming journalists, when in reality, those voices of game journalists have been being snuffed out for quite a while, thanks to YouTubers, such as myself, and other types of media that people like to consume in terms of video games. Maybe if these journalists would stop parading politics all the time, would stop promoting games that are pushing political agendas inside of those games specifically, and just talk about how good games actually are, or provide actual commentary on video games, maybe then people would actually start listening to them. But until they do, you're not going to see that, because they're just going to give every game a 7. great job. So ladies and gentlemen, let me know what you guys think in the comments section down below. What do you think is going to be Game of the Year this year? And what are you going to be expecting as well? And what changes would you in fact make? Now, if you want to see more of this kind of content, more PC port reviews, gaming news, my hot takes on the gaming industry, and Steam Deck videos, as well as fanboy content, subscribe to the channel. We're on our way to 76K. I just want to say thank you guys very much. If you want to have Discord access or emotes during live streams, become a YouTube member. It's as low as a dollar. If you don't want to spend the buck, don't sweat it. Come on down to the live stream, hang out. You'll have a great time. Also, if you just want free emotes, download the Better TTV extension for your browser and you get free animated emotes to use during the live stream. It's a hell of a great time. Trust me, Saturday nights, 8:45 p.m. Eastern, you're going to love it. I promise. With all that being said, though, thank you guys so much for watching. Hope you have a great one, and I'll see you next time.